Hi guys, how are you? I hope you guys are doing well and studying at home also. So today we are going to start with our chapter 4 materials, in which we are going to study about their classification in the form of either metals or non-metals. Now I'm sure you would have been aware of these terms, metals and non-metals, even before. But however, in this chapter, now we are going to study specifically about these metals and non-metals based upon number one, their physical properties, and number two, their chemical properties. These two things we are going to mainly study about the metals and non-metals, and we are going to find out what is actually the difference between them. That how do you classify a given material as a metal or a non-metal. Now, before getting on to the actual equations part and all, I would first like you to focus upon the image that I've shown here. Now these are some of the examples of metals. Now as you can see, you know, aluminium is there, copper is there, and then you have bronze, brass, steel. Now in all of these, if you notice, you know, they are pretty shiny and they are hard kind of substances. Now let me show you some pictures of non-metals. Now these are the examples of non-metal. As you can see, carbon, sulfur and red phosphorus. Now these are usually not as hard, as you can see, you know, you can already see that they are in the powder form, and also they are not even shiny and lustrous, right? This is just so that I'm giving you a mental representation of how do they actually look, the metals and non-metals. Now let us try to study about their physical properties first of all. Now if you remember, by physical properties we means what is their outside physical appearance, how do they look, what is their appearance, are they soft, are they shiny or are they dull. All of these, you know, simple properties will come into the category of physical properties. Now let us see, here I've compared them in a table. As you can see, I have taken some examples like iron nail, coal, aluminium and copper, right? If I talk about their appearance, now as I just shown you in the picture, you know, the metals that were there, they all were basically shiny, you know, and they had a lustrous effect in them basically. So iron nail, aluminium, copper, and you know, even some other metals that you can think of as the examples, you will find them that they have a shiny appearance. Whereas if you talk about coal, it does not really shine like a metal, does it? Right? So in this way, you are able to think that, you know, that metals have this physical appearance that they are shiny. And shiny has another word which is also known as lustrous. We can also say that the metals are lustrous and the non-metals are non-lustrous. We can say that. Now, if I talk about the other parameter, the other physical parameter more specifically, if I talk about their hardness, like are they very hard or are they soft or are they brittle? So obviously, you know, like iron, aluminium and copper, if I ask you to just simply break them up, can you break them into pieces? Not actually, but you do can break a cool piece by hammering it or by throwing it from a height, but these metals are not going to break so easy. So the other property of hardness is also that metals are very hard usually, except one or two few, you know, exceptions. Like sodium is a metal, however it is an exception because it is soft, but all of the other metals are on the majority, they are hard. And the non-metals are not very hard, or we sometimes also say that they are brittle. That means they easily break upon, you know, when a force is applied. Next, if we talk about some specific physical properties, the number one which comes is malleability. Now, what do we mean by malleability? Now, before just actually explaining this term, I would like you to go back to the example of aluminium foil and the normal silver covering that is put upon sweets and all. Now, they are also metals, right? And the thing is that those metals have been actually turned up into the shape of very thin sheets, right? So metals have this ability that they can easily be drawn or beaten down in the form of very thin sheets like aluminium foil and just like the example of sweets that I told you. So malleability is when you hammer a metal, you know, you apply force upon to it, it keeps on changing into, you know, thin sheets. It keep getting flattened and flattened as and when you keep on applying more force onto it. And in fact, gold is the most malleable metal. You know, it can be beaten down into very thin layer of gold sheets that are there. And if you see here, I've tried to show you that what is the factor behind them that makes these metals malleable. Now, this is basically a microscopic arrangement or microscopic picture to show the atoms of the metal. Now, initially, when the metal is at the normal state, you know, the atoms are stacked one over the other. Now, when you apply force onto it, these layers basically slide past one over the other and eventually they get aligned in one single line, which eventually gives you one single thin sheet. Now, why is it that, you know, they are not getting broken apart? This is because metals, they have very high forces of attraction between these atoms. And that is the reason why, you know, they can slide past one to another, but they will not get apart from each other. So we say that metals, they change shape when an applied force causes these layers of atom to slip over each other. This is the property which, you know, makes the malleable, which makes the metals so malleable. And we will discuss about one more property. This reason also holds true for that one. I'll let you know in a little while. Apart from this, if we talk about the non-metals, are they malleable? Like, I mean, if I talk about carbon, sulfur and red phosphorus, if I ask you to convert them into sheets of carbon, then it is not possible, because the moment you will hammer onto these non-metals, they will simply break down. That is because they are brittle. And why is that so? Because the forces of attraction that are there in between these atoms are very low, and as a result, the atoms are not able to slide over each other. They simply fall apart. That is the reason why the forces of attraction are weak. So we say that metals are not malleable, or we can also say they are non-malleable, right? Now, this is the second property, physical property only, that is conduction of heat and electricity. Now, I'm sure these two are the points which I'm sure you must be aware of. Now, if you remember, in your lower classes, you had studied about this simple setup by which you can test that a material can conduct electricity or not. There's a simple battery, there's a bulb, and here you can insert the sample which is to be tested. Now, obviously, like here I've shown that if you put a key over here of metal, the bulb is going to glow. That means metals are allowing the circuit to complete, and it shows that the metals are good conductors of electricity. Now, how about heat? Now, again, this is something which you have learned in your lower classes. Metals can also conduct heat. If you remember this diagram, like suppose on this metal wire or metal plate, if you put up some wax over here and on the other end, that is this side, you start heating it up, after some time you will see that the wax over here, it starts melting down and falling down. Why is that so? Because the atoms have this ability to conduct heat and transfer it to the other end. What is it known as? Conduction. And so metals are also good conductors of heat. And if you see here, that why is the actual reason that, you know, they are good conductors of both heat and electricity? This you will study in higher classes. I'm just giving you a brief over here, that, you know, the actual microscopic level, if we talk about, these metals actually have free electrons. By free electrons, we mean those electrons are free to move around in the structure of metal. And as a result, as in when the electric field or the heat is applied, you know, these electrons can simply move in that direction, and that is the reason why they are good conductors of heat and electricity. Now, if we talk about the non-metals, obviously you can check it with these two activities only. Like if you change the sample over here with a non-metal, the bulb is not going to glow. And similarly, as for the conduction, if we talk about the very simple thing, the handles of pans, they are not made of metals. Why? Because, you know, metals can conduct, whereas the non-metals do not conduct heat and electricity. Now let us come to the third point, that is ductility. Now what is this? If you can see the diagram or this over here, in this you will see that, you know, these are actually wires. Wires of what? Wires of metal they are. So this is another interesting property, that metals can be even changed in the form of thin wires. What was the first point? Malleability. There we were changing the metal into sheets, very thin sheets. Here what are we changing them into? We are changing them into wires. And again, metals are ductile, but non-metals are not ductile. So I can say that metals are, yes, they are ductile, and for non-metals they are not ductile. So ductility is defined as the ability by which they can be drawn into wires. So this is another a physical property. Now you might be wondering that how do these wires are formed by the metals, or how are the metals drawn into wire. So this is a simple diagram which I'm trying to show here. What they have, these people have, is they have molds, or basically cast. These molds and casts are used in order to give the shape to the metal. Now if you can see, this shape is such that, you know, when the metal is passing from here, the space keeps on decreasing. As you can see, it is getting less and less, and by the time it comes out from the other end of this mold, the wire is changes its shape and it becomes thin. So with the help of mold and cast it is done. And how it is done? When a lot of force is applied. And where is the force applied? It is usually applied onto the heated metal. When metal is heated to a very, very great temperature, you know, it does not actually become liquid, but it melts to give a molten solution. That molten solution is then passed through this mold and it is changed up into wires. I hope this is much is clear. Next physical property is about sonorosity. What is that? Now if you would have observed, like any metal thing, if you try to strike it with the surface, it produces a ringing sound, right? Whereas if I ask you to take a wooden stick and then you hit it on a surface, will it produce a ringing sound? No. So materials which produce ringing sound on striking a surface are called sonorous objects. And all metals, they are sonorous. Whereas if I talk about the non-metals, they are non-sonorous. So this is another property about the physical metals and non-metal. And again, this is the physical property that we are discussing. So these were the main properties, main points on which we can distinguish the metals and non-metals. And let's try to define them till now. So if we try to define the metals by now, we can simply say that the metals are those material which possesses the properties like they're hard, they're lustrous, malleable, ductile, sonorous, good conductors of heat and electricity. They are called as metals, right? And obviously, if I now ask you how can you define the non-metals, you know, all of those properties which I've just mentioned here, you're just going to turn them into their opposite. So you can define the non-metals as, like, you know, they are soft, they are dull in appearance, they break down easily, they are not sonorous, they are poor conductors of heat and electricity. These metals are called as non-metals. So this is how you can distinguish a metal and a non-metal based upon their physical properties. Till now we have not talked about the chemical properties. These are only the physical properties. That means all of these properties were just the outside features. Now let us see what are the chemical properties. Now in the chemical properties, now we are going to talk about certain reactions which are specific to metals, certain reactions which are specific to non-metals. So the number one chemical property is that we are going to study is reaction with oxygen. Now if you remember, in class 7 we had talked about formation of rust. Now how does rust form? When iron is in the presence of two things, that is number one, oxygen, and the other was water, or in other words I can say moisture, that is there. These two were the necessary conditions. What was the resulting product that was getting formed? An oxide. An oxide of what was formed? Of iron. So iron oxide was getting formed, and this is commonly known as rust. And if you try to check it with a litmus paper, you will find that it is basic in nature. That means it is going to turn red litmus into blue. So this means that, you know, metals are basically reacting with oxygen to form metal oxide, right? Iron is forming iron oxide, magnesium will form magnesium oxide, aluminium will form aluminium oxide, and so on. And regarding this basicity, I'll just discuss this in a while with the one example that we have done before. Again, here we have shown the reaction of copper with moist air. That means here also we are talking about the rusting, but not of copper, but of, not of iron, but of copper. So when copper reacts with, you know, moist air, it also reacts with the carbon dioxide that is there in the atmosphere, and it forms basically two things. One is copper hydroxide and the other is copper carbonate. Now you might be wondering, why did this hydroxide come here instead of oxide? Copper oxide is formed, but they are showing the further reaction. That means the copper oxide that is formed, it further reacts up to form copper hydroxide. So this is the eventual final reaction, and this is a complex reaction basically, because it is reacting with not just oxygen but also carbon dioxide and water. It is a slightly different case. But again, this is only corrosion of the metal only, because, you know, this kind of structure is formed, and as you can see, this is basically a green coating that develops. So this is again basic in nature, and here also a metal is oxide is basically formed, which eventually is getting converted into a hydroxide. By hydroxide we mean a hydrogen also gets added into it. And now let us discuss the previous example that we have done in class 7th. Now if you remember, we had actually performed this experiment also, that when you burn magnesium ribbon, magnesium is represented by Mg. It burns, that means it is reacting with oxygen. What does it form? Magnesium oxide, right? These white colors ashes were formed, and if you remember, it burns with a white, bright, dazzling flame. Now, if I ask you to check the nature of this, whether it is acidic or whether it is basic, what will you do? You will be checking it with a litmus paper. But what was the problem here? Can you check it directly? No. Why? Because the ashes that are formed here are solid in nature, and in order to perform the test with a litmus paper, your testing material has to be in the liquid form. So if you remember, what did we do next? We added water to magnesium oxide, and what did it form now? It formed magnesium hydroxide. Now simply you can dip the litmus paper into this solution and check it. If you remember now here that when you had checked up with the litmus paper, with the red litmus paper, it turned into blue. And when a red litmus turns into a blue colored, what does it tell you? That the tested material is basic in nature. So the overall generalization, what can we say about the reaction of metal with oxygen? We say that metals, they react with oxygen to form what? Metal oxides. Just like I told you, you know, magnesium will form magnesium oxide, iron will form iron oxide, like that. And what is the nature of these oxides? These oxides are basic in nature. You need to remember this thing very well. Now, what about non-metals? Let us see here. Now, if I talk about the non-metals. Now, non-metals also react with oxygen to form non-metal oxide. Because obviously, when you are using a non-metal, it will form a non-metal oxide. When you use a metal, it will form a metal oxide. But let us find their nature. What is the nature of their oxides that are formed? Now here in this figure, if you will see that the person has taken some sulfur powder in the spatula. Now what is sulfur? Sulfur is a non-metal, right? And here he has placed an inverted test tube. Inverted means ulta karke uske upar rakh dena. Now as and when the sulfur will burn, the fumes are getting collected up in this test tube. Now when enough fumes have been collected into this, you immediately turn this test tube straight and you add some water into it and close it. Why are we adding water? Because again, if you want to test the nature of oxides that are formed here, you cannot just check it in the solid or in the gaseous form. In order to check with a litmus paper, we can check it only in the liquid form. In the previous example, their magnesium oxide was solid. Here, it is in the gaseous form. So that is why we are adding water. So what actually is happening at the chemical level? Let's see here. Sulfur is reacting with oxygen to form sulfur dioxide. That means a non-metal oxide is getting formed. Then we added water. What happened then? When sulfur dioxide is mixed up with water, it forms H2SO3, which is also known as sulfurous acid. This is the reason, because when you put a litmus paper into this solution, then you will see that the blue litmus changes to red. What does it tell you? That the non-metal oxides are acidic in nature. This is what you need to remember. The metal oxides were basic in nature, non-metal oxides are acidic in nature. I hope this much is clear. Lastly, one more property that we will discuss in this video is that their reaction with water. Now, as I was telling you in the beginning that there is one metal, sodium. Now, this metal sodium is a very highly reactive metal. Why? Because when you simply take a very small piece, this small piece even if you take of this metal and you add it into water, it will immediately turn into flames. It will catch fire. Why is that so? Let us see here at the chemical level. What happens is when any metal react with water, it forms a metal hydroxide. Now focus on the word here. Here we are, a hydroxide is formed. Something related with hydro. That means both hydrogen and oxygen are playing the role over here. In oxygen, like in the previous example where we were discussing about reaction with oxygen, only oxygen was involved, so oxide was getting formed. Here both hydrogen and oxygen are involved, so what is getting formed? Hydroxide is formed. And obviously, since a metal is reacting, so what will form? A metal hydroxide will form. Apart from this, a side product is also formed. That means Side product means, apart from the major product, there is one more product form, that is the hydrogen gas. So hydrogen gas is also liberated. Now, in this reaction, what is it actually the thing that is, making the sodium catch fire? What happens is when the sodium reacts with water to form sodium hydroxide and hydrogen gas, this is a highly exothermic reaction. Now, if you remember exothermic reaction, they are the one which release lot of heat energy when through them. And as a result, when this heat energy is liberated, same time hydrogen gas is also getting formed. Now, hydrogen gas is a combustible gas. So this heat energy which is released, it makes this hydrogen catches fire. That is the reason why this sodium metal catches fire. Now, other metals also react to form their hydroxide, and there also hydrogen gas is released. But not in all the cases it catches fire, because different metals have different reactivity. Koi bahut zyada reactive hota hai to bahut kam hota hai. Kuch cases mein, like if I talk about aluminium will also form aluminium hydroxide, but it will not catch fire because they are not highly exothermic. They are exothermic, but unme itni zyada heat energy nahi release hoti that this hydrogen will catch fire. Only in very few cases like sodium and potassium, these two are very highly reactive cases, jahan pe bahut zyada energy release hoti hai, and the hydrogen that is getting released up, it catches fire because of that energy. But the other metals also, they also react, but with less power. And if I talk about the non-metals do not really react with water, no reaction. This is because of their chemical properties, that they prefer to be inert. By inert we mean they are not highly reactive. So if you are going to take sulfur or carbon and you are going to mix up with water, nothing is going to happen. However, these non-metals are not as such reactive in water, but they are reactive in air. Now here I've shown you a picture of phosphorus. Basically this phosphorus, if you will just keep it in air for few seconds at room temperature, it will immediately catch fire. So this is because phosphorus is highly reactive in air, and phosphorus is a non-metal. However, it does not really react with water. And since these metals, like sodium and potassium and the non-metal phosphorus, these are highly reactive in water and air. So where to keep them? They are stored under kerosene oil. Why? Because this kerosene oil cuts off the supply of air and water, and in that they can stay safe. So these were the two chemical properties that I have discussed. There are a few more chemical properties of metals and non-metals which we are going to discuss in the next video. I hope all the physical properties and these two chemical properties which we have discussed in this video are clear to you, right? So till then, do go through each concept wisely and revise and keep learning. Thank you.